وما أرسلنا قبلك إلا رجالا نوحي إليهم فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون.
بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومواله. Last week we finished the verbs. Today we're going to start with nouns. The scholars, they divide them into the nouns which they have dhamma all the time, the nouns which they have fatha all the time, and the nouns which they have kasra all the time. So meaning, they say, another way you can say, the nouns which they are marfu', the nouns which they are mansub, the nouns which they are majrur or makhfu'. So we start with the chapter of marfu', the nouns which they have the dhamma all the time. We start with the fa'il, because is al-fa'il huwa kima yaqul ummu al-bab, is the mother of the chapter of the marfu'. Al-fa'il is definition, we can say a noun which is preceded by its own verb. Very simple. The subject, this definition has three things. One, it tells us that the noun, it is a noun, is not a verb. Number two, it tells us that it is marfu' and is not mansub or majrur. Number three, it tells us that the verb, the fa'il always preceded by its own verb. The difference between when we say marfu' or we say raf', or we say majrur or we say al-jar, or we say mansub or we say nasb, al-jar is, or al-raf' or nasb, is the name of the state of the Arab. And when we say marfu', mansub, majrur, is the name of the word that has the state. So instead of saying has the state of raf', we say is marfu'. Instead we say has the state of nasb, we say marfu', mansub, and so on. For example, from the Quran, for the fa'il, Allah says, وَيَوْمَ يَقُومُ النَّاسُ. So يَقُومُ is a verb, and nasu is the one who make the qiyam. So النَّاسُ is the fa'il. So as you can see, it has a dhamma. So we say يَوْمَ يَقُومُ النَّاسُ. يَقُومُ is fa'il mudari', النَّاسُ fa'il marfu'. Another example, وَيَوْمَ يَعَضُّ الظَّالِمُ. يَعَضُّ is fa'il mudari'. الظَّالِمُ, as you can see, it has a dhamma, because the ظَالِم, the one who made the action of يَعَضُّ, as you can see, it has a dhamma. So from now on, every time you read in Arabic and you come across a subject, a fa'il, make sure you put a dhamma. And if someone read in front of you a sentence which contains a subject and he puts the wrong vowel on the subject, like reading it with fatha or kasra, tell him that's wrong. You should read it with the dhamma. And if he asks you, what is your proof? Don't tell him the proof is Allah says or his prophet, because there is no such a thing. The proof is, tell him that's how the Arab spoke. So the scholars of the Nahu, they followed and searched through the tongue of the Arabs, and they never came across someone read or spoke the dual al-fa'il with other than the dhamma. The next noun is al-mubtada' wal-khabar, nominal and its predicate. The definition of a mubtada, it is a noun which is unaffected by grammatical factors that might alter its vowel marking, and it comes at the beginning of a sentence generally. That's why it is called mubtada. It's called mubtada because ibtada'na bihi al-kalam, we started the sentence with it. That's why it's called mubtada. So the mubtada in that definition has three things. One, it is a noun. Two, it is marfu'. Number three, it is unaffected by grammatical factors. There is nothing before it, because usually the grammatical factors which affect the vowel marking comes before the word. Before the word that affects it. But the mubtada, there is nothing before it. So the scholar, they say, it's fact, the factor that caused the Dhamma is ma'nawi, which is al-ibtida, which is something ma'nawi, which we can't feel, we can't see, that's called ma'nawi. So the starting of the sentence, that what caused the Dhamma of the al-mubtada. Al-khabar, its definition is, it is a noun that it is attributed or connected to the mubtada. So it has three things. One, it is a noun. Two, it is marfu', and three, it is connected to the mubtada. Here, the factor which caused the dhamma of al-khabar is al-mubtada. So here is not ma'nawi, because al-khabar is the one it caused the dhamma of the al-khabar, unlike the mubtada. The mubtada, there is nothing before it. What caused the dhamma of it is because we started the sentence with it. For example, of mubtada al-khabar, al-ilmu nurun, as-sadaqatu burhanun. Al-ilmu, if we say al-ilmu by itself, we know it's knowledge. If we say nurun by itself, it is light. But when we say al-ilmu nurun, so now nurun, which is al-khabar, gave us information about the ilm, which is al-ilm is a light. Same for sadaqatu burhanun. As-sadaqa is charity, burhanun is like a proof. But when they connected, the khabar completes the mubtada. So here, as-sadaqatu burhanun, that means the sadaqa, sadaqatu burhanun, that means the word burhan, it is a proof, it completes the sadaqa. So it means here, the sadaqa is a proof of belief, a proof of iman. And we can make Arab to mubtada, for example, al-ilm, we say mubtada, marfu' bil-dhamma. Nurun, khabarun marfu' bil-dhamma. As-sadaqatu burhanun, as-sadaqa, mubtada, marfu' bil-dhamma. Burhanun, khabarun, marfu'un bil-dhamma. The rule, we can say for this lesson, al-fa'il, it is a noun, and it is always marfu' with al-dhamma. Al-mubtada, it is a noun, and it is always marfu' with al-dhamma as well. Al-khabar, it is a noun, and it is always marfu' with al-dhamma. So from now on, whenever you read mubtada, you should put al-dhamma. Whenever you read khabar, you should put al-dhamma. Whenever you read al-fa'il, the doer, you should put al-dhamma on it. There is other nouns, but I think three for beginners is enough. And then inshallah, in future, we will build more. Until next time, subhanakallah bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.